Hey, welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, thank you so much for joining us. I'm really excited to have you here. If you're returning, welcome back. I'm really excited to have you here too. But anyway, I hope you had the absolute best Christmas. I hope that you got everything you wanted. If you didn't celebrate Christmas, I hope that the holidays were just absolutely wonderful for you. And I think we're all looking forward to the new year. I'm hoping that it's a little chiller than the last couple of years have been. I know it's been rough. It's been so rough, but I hope this finds you so well, and I hope you had the absolute best of holidays if you celebrated or didn't, just all of it. I am wearing the same outfit that I wore in my last video. I am recording this all in one day. I was traveling over the holidays, spending some time with my family, and I am going to be spending some time with my family away, so I won't have time to film or anything like that, but I did still try to want to get something out, so this is just what I'm wearing again. So please excuse me, I promise I did shower after this. But yeah, either way, if you are interested, you can hit the little subscribe button down below and the little bell icon so you can be notified when I upload. If you're interested, if you're not, that's totally fine. But yeah, I do also want to give a quick warning that some of the things we talk about here can get kind of heavy. So if that's something your mental health cannot handle, just go ahead and click off this video and I'll catch you somewhere else. But please remember that your mental health is always going to be so much more important than any YouTube video ever will be. So yeah, let's jump into today's story. I will say today's is a little bit shorter than some of the other ones that I've been doing. There's just not a lot out there about this case that I could really find. But I also didn't see it talked about very much, so I wanted to bring a little bit of awareness to this case. So today we're going to be talking about Rachel Mellon Skemp. Rachel was a beautiful 13-year-old girl. She was in 7th grade and living in Bolingbrook, Illinois. Rachel was very well liked by her peers. She was a popular girl. She just didn't have trouble making any friends. She was just a good person. She was just good, a good human. Sadly, Rachel's parents divorced when she was very young, and her father moved to Dallas, Texas. Her father's name was Jeff. And so Rachel stayed in Illinois with her mother, Amy, and her stepfather, Vincent. January 31st of 1996, Rachel woke up and she wasn't feeling great, so she decided to stay home. Now, I'm not entirely sure if Vincent was working, if he wasn't working, but either way, Vincent decided to stay home with Rachel that day while Amy and the rest of their family went to work and to school. But Rachel would never be seen again. She was last seen sleeping in her bed around 2:30 p.m. Rachel was reported missing around 5 p.m. that evening, so when police went to go interview Vincent, because he was the one that was at home with her all day long, he told them that he and Rachel had spent the day just kind of vegging out. Rachel wasn't feeling well, so they spent some time playing some Nintendo, I guess watching TV. They were just relaxing that day so that Rachel could get the rest she needed to go back to school the next day and just get better in general. Vincent said that from 2 to 2:30 in between there, Rachel said that she was going to go take a nap. Vincent decided that he was going to go walk the dog. Vincent said that he left the house with the dog, but he didn't lock the door behind him. He figured he wasn't going to go far and he wasn't going to be gone very long, so I guess he didn't see the need in locking the door, but he said that while he was out on this walk with the dog got out of its collar and started chasing a rabbit. So Vincent says that he was running around looking for the dog for about 30 minutes and he finally gave up looking for the dog and went home. Vincent says that he got home about 3 p.m. and in some parts it said that he checked on Rachel when he got back and she was still sleeping, and some said that he hadn't gone and checked on Rachel when he got back. So I'm not entirely sure what the real story is there, but either way, he came back and just kind of left Rachel alone. But either way, nobody knew that Rachel was missing until 5 p.m. when Amy came home from work and the rest of the family came home from school and, you know, doing all their other things. That's when the police were called and a search started for Rachel. Amy did say that it took police about an hour to get to their house after she had called police, which I find a little bit strange. But she said that it took police about an hour to get to the house, and that when they did show up to the house, it seemed like they weren't taking Rachel's disappearance very seriously. It kind of seemed like they just kind of wrote it off as a runaway. But either way, the community came together and they started looking for Rachel. They were looking in the air. They were looking with horses, on horseback, on ATVs. People were walking. This was a very, very cold day. Like, I want to say it was negative 30 or something like that. Like, it was a very, very cold day. So people bundled up and just started looking everywhere for Rachel. But despite the searches, no one was able to find her. Like I said, police were kind of seemed to be writing it off as a runaway. But the thing is that Rachel hadn't taken anything with her. Her pillows and blankets were gone, but her shoes were still at home, her coats were still at home. And I really feel like if a teenager was planning on running away, they would take other things with them, like their toothbrush, toothpaste, like a brush, a comb, or something like that. But really, it seemed like Rachel just kind of disappeared. All of her things were still there, and I just don't see her being a runaway without taking more with her. Her father, Jeff, came down from Dallas to help with the search when he realized that Rachel was missing. When he got to Illinois, he told police that Rachel had recently called his mother, so Rachel's grandmother, her maternal grandmother. But this wasn't allowed by Amy or Vincent. They did not allow Rachel to talk to her father's side of the family. So I said maternal, but I meant paternal. But Amy and Vincent, it seemed like they didn't allow Rachel to talk to her father's side of the family. So the fact that she had called her grandmother on her father's side was a little bit strange. So police started looking at the angle that possibly Jeff's family, so Rachel's father's family, had maybe gotten tired of not seeing Rachel and had decided to just take her so that they could be reunited with her. But this would quickly lead to nothing. Police soon realized that Jeff's family did not have anything to do with Rachel's disappearance. When police searched Rachel's bedroom, they found her diary stuffed in between her mattresses. Looking into it, they're obviously going to read her diary since they're searching for a missing girl. They found entries that said that Vincent had SA'd Rachel in the past. So this led police to look into Vincent a little bit deeper. So like I said, Vincent did say that he had checked in on Rachel, but then there were some reports that said he hadn't checked on her, so I'm not entirely sure which one is there. But according to Vincent, he did check on Rachel after he had gone out looking for this dog. He did also say that a real estate broker had brought the dog back to his house later on in the day, but police were never able to find that real estate broker. So, like, who knows where the dog actually went or if the dog was actually missing. But Vincent kept to the story that he told police, where Rachel had gone to sleep between 2 and 2:30, and he had taken the dog for a walk, and the dog got off the leash and started chasing a rabbit, and he spent the time looking for him. That's the story that Vincent was sticking with. So I guess what Vincent was trying to say is that somebody entered the house while he was in there, but there was no forced entry. There was no evidence of forced entry into the house. And it seems a little strange to me that someone would try to enter the house to kidnap somebody while they knew that there was an adult in the other room. There were also no witnesses that had seen Vincent running around looking for this dog. No one had seen him walking the dog. No one had seen him looking for the dog, nothing like that. They lived in a pretty busy area, so I feel like somebody would have seen something if, you know, Vincent was out looking for this dog. Vincent was also covered in scratches, but he said that he had recently serviced one of their vehicles, and that's where the scratches had come from, not from hurting Rachel. But when they looked into Vincent's background, they found that Vincent had a pretty long history. He had several domestic violence cases against him, which doesn't look good in this case. Vincent would also agree to taking multiple polygraph tests, but he failed all of them. But despite all of this is pretty circumstantial evidence, so police were not able to arrest him for the disappearance of Rachel. It would take Amy some time to separate from Vincent, but they would eventually get back together, and they kind of went off the radar. And I guess I understand why prosecutors wouldn't want to prosecute without more solid evidence because of double jeopardy. if you're watching in a different country, and I'm sure you know what Double Jeopardy is, but for anyone who doesn't know, Double Jeopardy is if you go to trial and are found innocent by a group of your peers, by the jury, then prosecutors are not able to charge you with those, they're not able to press charges against you with that. Even if new evidence comes to light, like, you're free to go. So in cases like OJ Simpson, where he was found innocent, even if OJ came out and bluntly said, "I did it," that he cannot be charged with that crime again. And that's to prevent prosecutors from being able to hold charges over your head, essentially. But so I can understand why prosecutors wouldn't want to press charges against Vincent without more solid evidence. But at the same time, it seems pretty obvious what happened here. But no more evidence has come to light, and Rachel has never been found. Considering Rachel's accusations in her diary, it could be possible that Vincent stayed home, or specifically wanted to stay home with Rachel so he could attack her again. The rest of the family was at work and school, so he basically had the house to himself along with Rachel and could kind of do what he wanted. As far as Rachel's body never being found, looking at the surrounding area of their house, there are several rivers and smaller bodies of waters and wooded areas, but Lake Michigan is also only 45 minutes away from their house. So if he had all day to do what he wanted to do with Rachel, he could pretty much have taken her anywhere and have dumped her body and, you know, created this timeline saying that he, you know, she went to sleep and all these things and she just vanished. I guess it could be possible that Rachel was taken by a stranger, but also, again, I don't see that happening, considering who would break into a home knowing that there's, you know, somebody awake and around the house, you know, throughout the day. That seems pretty risky, like pretty risky behavior, when you could probably find a victim who would be easier to take with less witnesses. I guess it's also possible that Rachel could have ran away, but, you know, wouldn't there be sightings of her? Wouldn't she have come forward eventually? Like, she would be much older by now. I feel like she would have came back or, you know, made her presence known. And also, if she had ran away, why wouldn't she have taken some toiletries, some, you know, extra clothes, a coat, since it was so cold outside? Why wouldn't she have put her shoes on? Like, anything like that. And I also think there would have been sightings of her after this if she had ran away. There was also a theory I saw that Drew Peterson, I did a case, a video on Drew Peterson, but he was also a cop during this time, so some people think that Drew Peterson might be involved. I find this one pretty far-fetched. I don't think he was involved. I think that he was just dangerous to the women that he married. But yeah, that's kind of the end of the story. There's just so not very much out there. It seemed like Rachel just kind of vanished into thin air. So I think it's pretty obvious what happened to her, and there's just not enough evidence to convict him of murder. But that also makes me think, like, how many murderers have gone free because there wasn't enough evidence, or there was circumstantial evidence at best? And that's kind of a scary thought. Or I just wonder how many people have gone free, or, you know, not been convicted of murder because there just wasn't enough evidence. Pretty scary. But yeah, I would love to know your thoughts about this down in the comments. So yeah, just leave them down in the comments and yeah, let me know what you think. But that's pretty much all I have for you today. Today was a much shorter video, but yeah, let me know what you think and bounce some theories off of me. If you know about this story and you know more than what I'm presenting here, please leave it down in the comments. I'd love to have a conversation with you down there. But yeah, like I said, that's pretty much all I have. So I hope you have the absolute best of New Year. Please stay safe. If you're doing whatever, always remember to have a DD if you're drinking. It's kind of cheesy, but yeah, please stay safe, over the holidays, this last holiday weekend, and I hope this finds you well, and I'm sending you so much love, and I will see you next week. Bye.